Italia, bajo la dirección de Débora Dunfin y Paola Marciano. Como resultado de su tesis obtuvo dos menciones especiales, una mención honorífica en la obtención del grado de doctor en astrofísica por la UNAM y en 2015 el premio Paris Business al mejor estudiante astrofísico del Instituto de Astronomía de México. Tiene varias publicaciones en el tema de los cuásares y 7 presentaciones orales a congresos y una de ellas ya incluso con los datos que está haciendo ahora del GTC aquí de Quasares. Su tesis trató sobre el estudio de las propiedades físicas en la BLR en una muestra de cuásares a redshift intermedio estudiando espectros, con análisis espectroscópico de líneas de baja ionización en el infrarrojo, que es lo que nos va a presentar hoy, y también haciendo modelos, códigos de fotoionización para estudiar cuáles eran las condiciones físicas que le han producido esas líneas que observan. Ha estado en varios lugares, sobre todo en Italia, y ahora aquí, que esperamos que continúe con nosotros. Ella tiene ahora mismo una estancia postdoctoral en el extranjero financiada por CONAPI y va a estar hasta febrero de 2018 trabajando aquí, y pertenece también a nuestro grupo de investigación y a nuestro proyecto de investigación. Y quería resaltar solo una cosa, que además Mariloli está muy comprometida con la población indígena, de hecho tiene una financiación de CONACyT para un proyecto que se llama Mirando al Cielo, que es iniciación a la investigación para las comunidades indígenas científicas, y de hecho ahora se va ella a México por un tiempo porque tiene que allí unos cursos. También ha sido profesora en la UNAM, si no recuerdo yo mal, de cursos de física y de astronomía y matemáticas, que están aquí, de física contemporánea como ayudante de profesores de asignatura, de astrofísica extragaláctica y cosmología y de cálculo integral diferencial en matemáticas. Y bueno, pues encantados de escucharla y de tenerla aquí con nosotros trabajando.
¿Está encendido el ordenador este? Sí.
Bueno, pues gracias por venir.
¿Ya antes funcionó?
Sí, pero no es como si se hubiera quedado en stand-by. Vamos. Ah, vale.
Ya. Teléfono.
¿Vale? Bien.
Mi teléfono.
¿Se apagó?
Ya, te lo voy.
Okay, thank you, Johnny, and thanks everyone for coming. So now I'm going to present my PhD thesis that is about the low ionization lines in quasars, and especially my PhD was focused on the calcium to triplet, that it is a low ionization lines. And also we found several things. One of these things is that the calcium to triplet is emitted by the accretion disk, the outer part of the accretion disk, but also can help us to infer some things about the star formation. So it is the classical feature where we have the acting galactic enclave. So I'm focused only in quasar that are the most luminous AGN. So they say that maybe we are view the source in this direction. So in this direction we can see the central region of the AGN, so the VLR and also the Napoleon region, some cases the Taurus. And in this part, it is a typical spectrum of the AGN type 1, when we can see the several kind of lines that we have. So we can recognize, for example, that we have low ionization lines, that are like the Hydrogen lines, like H alpha, H gamma. I don't know where is H beta, that have to be in this region. Also, we have high ionization lines like carbon 4. However, it is an average spectra, but if we if we go to several sources, we can find and we can see that not all the lines have the same behavior. For example, here it is the age beta line. So it is the age beta line for one that it's a narrow line super one, and it's age beta for other source 3C 110. So you can see here how the line, the broad line, it's very narrow, but in this case we have a broader component, but also we have to include other broader components. Also, the behavior of oxygen 3 here it's not so high, but here the lines are so large and also they are very narrow. In the case of carbon 4, you can see here for 1CG1 we have a blue shift component, but if we go to the broader AGN, we can see that the profile is more symmetrical. So these kind of things can give you information about the physics inside the AGN. Okay, so based on the spectral properties observed in many of the type 1 AGN, we can find that we can organize based on these properties, and it is the objective of the eigenvector 1. Eigenvector 1 proposed that if we can organize the AGN type 1 according to the spectral properties, and the scheme is based on four parameters. The first parameter is the full width of the H beta broad component, and H beta is going to be considered like the low ionization line. The second parameter is the ratio between the equivalent width of Fe2 and H beta. And this parameter are Fe, it's going to give the information of the intensity of the Fe3. For example, here, in this region, we have a strong Fe2 emitters, and in this region, we have the low emitters. The third parameter is the X-ray sub-index, and the fourth parameter is the carbon-4 asymmetry. And carbon-4 is going to be a prototype line of the high ionization line. So, if we measure the properties of these lines, we can do this kind of diagram. This diagram is the mainly eigenvector 1 diagram. So if we plot the full width of the H beta component and also the intensity of the RFE, we can find that the AGNs are organized in a band. But also, we can find, for example, interesting things that, for example, the radio quadrants are located in the upper, in the top of the panel, and mainly the radio loud are located in this region. So, this diagram can give you a lot of information. Yes.
The radio loud.
Radio loud.
Population B.
Yes. Here. In the top of the panel and radio white in the bottom.
A question just for those of you who are completely, I come from a completely different field.
Yes.
So this comes out from principal component analysis, mm-hmm. I suppose, for a vector space, right? And just in a very simple phrase, what does it solve for me that hasn't solved before this scheme? Or, I mean, why has this been done? I'm not sure. I'm being thrown into cold water here and trying to understand what this eigenvector 1 scheme, this PCA scheme, is it good for compared? I mean, what does it much better? It must be doing something much better than previously, so what is it?
Well, the eigenvector 1 is based on the principal component analysis. So, if you take, for example, several of the properties and only you correlate it.
Yes. This is something new. Why are you doing this PCA? There must be something that is doing much better than previous classification schemes.
Jack.
Yeah. I mean, just for those of us who are just thrown in here.
In the 90s, between 1990 and 2000, enough good spectra, signal to noise of 20 to 50 became available, that many accurate measures of line properties were obtained. Before that time, it was unclear what correlations existed between these properties. The PCA has identified in eigenvector 1 what are the strongest correlations between the different emission lines, and also we added X-ray and UV line, and so most of the correlation power quite services is these parameters, and we think that they're driven by the Eddington ratio. So in a very short time, with better data for more than 100 quasars, we identified the principal correlations and probably the principal physical drivers of those correlations. So the reason is clear. The only other way to do it would be simply to make a million plots. And the PCA. Yeah,
but what's the physics that becomes clear?
The physics that becomes clear is that the principal driver of this sequence is the Eddington ratio of the source, not the luminosity or black hole mass, for example. So we think to have isolated the principal physical driver of this sequence.
Okay.
An empirical scheme, but if we see the property, we can see that there is not only a random behavior, there is a physics behind this. So, the agents inside the eigenvector 1 scheme can be divided into populations. Population A, that is focused to the strong, is focused to the narrow type 1 AGN, and the population B, and the division is around 4,000 kilometers per second. Why the division is here? Well, we don't know. So we think that here there is a transition, an evolution transition here, but in this moment it is not clear. But in this case, you can see, for example, if we go for the narrow band super 1 to the broader AGNs, so in this case, if we go in this direction, you can see that seems that there is an evolution of the AGNs. So, one of these properties, we can find several behaviors. For example, population by definition is only it's going to be a full width of H beta less than 4,000 kilometers. There is a scarcity of rather loud sources. They show a strong and moderate F2 emission, a soft X-ray excess. High ionization broad lines show an asymmetry. And the broad lines are better described by Lorentzian. Also, this kind of things is only because the fit is better. There is a physical meaning here? I don't know. And the other feature is that they are radiating close to the Eddington limit. So here you can see two examples of the population A. It is the carbon-4 profile, and also you can see here the blue shift component, and this is the H beta, and H beta has an asymmetrical profile. In the other case, the population B properties shows a broader equivalent width, include the majority of the radio loud sources, the Fe2 emission, it is not so strong. The sources show a less prominent or not so great excess. It is one of the more important properties. The blue shift, the high ionization lines are symmetrical, and also they are well described by two Lorentzian models. So many of the properties are in this moment empirical, and we are in the way to find physics behind this. But if we also go to we analyze the properties like the accretion rate, the luminosity, the mass, ionization parameter, also electron density, we can see that also there is an evolution. So the eigenvector 1 could be considered like a main sequence for the type 1 AGN, because they have an evolution in the properties. So for many years, Jack, Paola, and also Deborah have been working in this topic, and they found many of these relations. But 2 years ago, Shen Ho taking the data for the SDSS, they confirmed the results. And also, it is the Shen Ho diagram, so you can see that it is all the SDSM sources, and they propose the same. So behind this has Jackton. It's that mainly the main drive is the Eddington radio, and what we are in the way to try to solve this. So there are, as I show you and at the beginning, inside the spectra we can find several kind of lines, high ionization lines and also low ionization lines. But inside the low ionization lines, there are two, there are a kind of lines that have a ionization potential less than 15. So these lines could be considered like the very low ionization lines. It is important because it is inside these lines, it is the Fe2. The Fe2 in the AGMs is very important because it is a coolant of the VLR, so we have to consider. Also, if we look for, if we see the Fe2 in the spectra, we can see that it is a pseudo continuum. So in some of the sources, especially the population B, we cannot say that, okay, Fe2 is not important. Fe2 is very important, so we have to consider. The problem is that the photoionization models cannot reproduce the flux radius when it's included the Fe2. The problem is that Fe2 has a complexity electronic structure. So it is a model by Siput and Prahan of 312 levels, electronic levels. So include this in a photoionization code is very difficult. So the proposal is that, well, when the people try to use the same physical conditions, for example, for the Androidian lines that are these, they found that they can reproduce. So they say, okay, maybe we have to change the properties. So when they change the properties, they found that yes, well, more or less, the Fe2 could be reproduced. So the proposal is that Fe2 is produced by other region different of the H beta line, a region that is called its very density and also is a shielded line. So Susico line, Jolie, Fairland, they propose that maybe this region is the outer part of the accretion disk. Because well, the physical conditions are the expected to be for this kind of lines. So well, the Fe2 is very complex, but so the point is try to look for other low ionization ions that has a electronic structure not so complexity. It is the case of the oxygen one and also the calcium two triplet. These two ions can be modeled only using a model of pi levels, that it is more easy than to use a model of more than 300 levels. Okay, so there are few jobs about the oxygen one and the calcium two triplet. The main point is that they are emitted in the near infrared, and if you go to farther redshift, it's very complicated. There are observational complications. Many of the jobs are focused only on the narrow line cipher one and cover only the low zeta samples. So the theoretical jobs are four only, and the observational works are five. It is an example of the, and also a comparison between the oxygen one and the calcium beta lines. You can see here the redshift, it is not so large. So the thing is that we have to include and go to high redshift to try to look what is the behavior of these sources. As I told you, it's very difficult to study the region if you want to go to higher redshift because there are observational complications. Oxygen 1 and calcium 2 show equivalent width, very weak. So it's a complicated compare, for example, with the H beta, it is around 10 times less, so it's difficult. Also, in some of the cases, the lines are totally blended, they are not isolated. Also, they are contaminated by telluric absorptions. And in this part of the spectra, The continuum, there are several continuums affecting. One of them is the continuum for the occasion this. The other is the continuum for the hot torus. And the other could be the contribution of the hot galaxy. So for many years, this job was waiting, and this kind of job focused on the oxygen 1 and calcium 2 was not taken again. But when the improve of the new instruments, we decide to use to take again the problem. So using the BLT spectra and also the ISOT spectrograph, we can to observe again new AGNs with a higher zeta. So our sample was observed with the BLT. We are focused only in quasars. We consider high luminosity objects. It's because we want that the oxygen 1 and the calcium 2 show a high intensity. We tried that the oxygen 1 and calcium 2 are not affected by the telluric lines, because after the correction to the telluric line, well, it's complicated. And also, we have the optical spectra, and it is very important because in this case, we can restrict our measures in the near infrared with the optical spectra. And also, the optical spectra are good, so it is more easy for us. There is other sample at low zeta that is the person sample. The person sample, the criteria of selection are different totally by us, because based on that the calcium 2 is very strong, and also the calcium 2 have to be very strong because they share, for example, physical conditions, and also they share ionization potentials. So they say that if the Fe2 is very strong, so calcium 2 have to be very strong. So we are only going to select Fe2 stronger emitters. They have 40 AGNs. 15 are only in 15 of them only the oxygen 1 and the calcium 2 are clearly observed. So you can see that here, in many of these objects, for example, are affected by the host galaxy. So when you eliminate the contribution of the host galaxy, it's not possible to have accurate measures. They have low luminosity AGNs, and they are focused only to a very, very, very low redshift. So our sample and the Pearson sample are complementary samples, and we can develop a better job. So here you can see how is the redshift distribution. Okay, so it is a near infrared POP-A spectra. POP-A spectra is the spectra that show the narrow lines. Narrow inside the broad lines, because it's difficult to confuse.
So
yes.
What's the wavelength range here?
Well, the wavelength range, we have 8,000, the majority of our sources in the near infrared cover. 8,000 to 9,000 and 9 to...
Mid-infrared?
Yes, near-infrared.
Near-infrared, 8,000 and 9,000.
Yes.
In Armstrongs.
Okay. Yes, yes.
Yeah,
yes, in Armstrongs, yes.
It's very, very thick in microns usually.
No.
So it's very, 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 very almost optical, right?
Yes,
so,
yes, it's close to the optical. And also it is others of the point. It's not, the spectrometers are not very good in this region.
But that's a risk, right?
Yes, they are in the risk rate, yes.
But the redshift is about the point.
My redshift here is around 2.1, more or less, yeah. Yes, yes, here is my redshift,
0.8 to 1.6.
Yes.
Sorry?
It's
okay, right? You observe.
Yes, yes.
Ah, okay, the
question.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I thought it was the observed wavelength. Sorry. Yes, the problem is, for example, if we want to observe sources here, the spectrometers are not very well in these regions, and also you have many of the telluric lines. So it's very complicated. So we are here, we have a relative bias, but well. Okay, so it is a population near infrared spectra. So it is the H-beta, and this is the calcium to region. So you can see how the H-beta has a very, very, very narrow line, a narrow broad line, if I could be said. Also, the Fe2 is very stronger. Because the oxygen 3 triplet, it is not so, so strong, it's, well, tiny. And also, if we go to the near infrared region, you can see here how the calcium 2 triplet is very, it's isolated. It is the only sources, I have absorbed a sample of 25 AGMs. And in only one sources, I could observe the calcium 2 triplet as isolated. It is more of the stronger sources in my sample. Here, for example, this line is the oxygen 1, and the other 1, 2, 3 is the calcium 2 triplet. These lines, that is the A664 line, it's the line that made in many of the sources. For me, it's important because I can fix with line with these lines the intensity of the calcium 2 triplet. Also, in the spectra, I can observe fashion line that is contaminated by the Fe2. Again, and in this object, I can see fashion 8. These kind of sources are very important now for me because I am working in a UV quasar sample. So if the objects that I have now in this moment, I can have the near infrared region, I can see a spectra like this. It is the UV spectra for this source, and you can see here how the carbon 4 is blue shifted. It has a very strong blue shift wind, but also the peak of the line is blue shifted, so it is stronger. These kind of sources show a radiating close to the Eddington radio, so they are very important also for me. But the problem is that many of the sources that I have in this moment, well, we don't have the near infrared observations, but maybe in the future, it is the things that maybe I can hope for my sources. Okay, it is a population B spectra. The lines are broader, so you can see how it's the change here. It is H beta and it is H alpha. The oxygen 3 triplet here, for example, show the narrow line, but also a blue shifted semi-broad component. So maybe oxygen 3 show here outflow. And the calcium 2 triplet, look at, for example, the spectra with the continuum. It's very clear because you can see here that it is only like a moon. We here compare with the other spectra, we can observe isolated triplets. So many of my sources have this kind of behavior. So the previous source that I show you, it's very important because it's the first time, and also the behavior, it's very, very different, and the physics again. So the figures that I show you previous show the multi-component fits. So in this moment, I only going to show how I perform the multi-component fit. So the first is to fit the continuum. The continuum is the accretion discontribution, that it's only a power law. Host galaxy contribution, well, we try to model, but in only one of my case, the host galaxy contribution has an important contribution that is higher than 10 times the quasar luminosity. It is this case. And we try also to model the contribution of the torus, but it was not important for us. So, the second, when we subtract the continuum, for the optical spectra, we fit the Fe2 contribution that is modeled by several templates. The next is to fit the broad component and also the very broad component. It is the case for a population B. So, it is the broad component and also the very broad component. So, you can see how the pink line is going to show the spectra. The next is to include, well, the narrow line component. In this case, there is a narrow line. After, we include the oxygen 3. And in this case, only oxygen 3 show the narrow lines. The next is, the blue shifted components. And at the final, we fit the coronal lines that are FE6 and FE2. So at the end, for the optical spectrum, we have a number of three parameters, 12, 15, and 80. It is very important because the optical spectrum has a signal to noise. So for us, it's very important, for example, to fix the properties of the H-beta lines, because the H-beta lines properties we are going to use in the near infrared, for example, in the passion lines. So it is very, very important. And also, maybe many of the communities say that the number of three parameters is so large. But well, we try to fix many of our properties to know the model dependent of other things. In the optical region, again, we have only the accretion discontribution, and as I told you, we have only in one case a stellar contribution of 10,000. In the same case, first we fit the FE2 template. It's important to say that the FE2 template for the near infrared, it's a newer template. It was not previous because also there are very complications. So the FE2 template was performed at the same time that my PhD and also a Brazilian group. Okay, after we fit the passion 9 and the passion 8 in the case, and in some cases the passion lines has a high intensity, so we decide in some of the cases to fit the pseudo continuum passion lines, for to say any. Okay, the next is to fix the oxygen 1, and the next is to fix the calcium 2 triplet. Calcium 2 triplet is an optically thick line, so the three lines have to be the same intensity. But the resolution of our spectra are no good to decide if the lines show a shift, so we fix only in the red frame. The next is to try to find, because here it's the passion continuum, because in some sources we can find a hint of this passion continuum. However, our spectral range is not so large, so it's very, very difficult. So at the end, we have 12 parameters. And also, it's important to say that we have several lines, for example, the passion lines, but only the free parameter is the flux. So maybe we can see that our model is not so bad. So here is the host galaxy contribution. The synthesis population models were performed from Yang Chen and Alessandro Bressan from CISA. And these are the properties of the galaxy that we found. And you can see here our spectrum. Okay, so if we take the person sample and our sample, and we perform the flux radius calcium 2 H beta, we can see how they are related. Here we have calcium 2 H beta and here FE2 H beta. So they form a strong correlation. So it is one of the things of the results that we can to be sure that the two lines are emitted by the same region. Also, we perform photoionization models. We use the photoionization code performed by Ferland, Claudi. So it is the main parameters that we consider, Matthews and Ferland continuum, because we have regular sources, the FE3, that also is very important, because I say that it is a column, density ionization, column density. Also, we have 10 to 23. And 10 to 25, it is very important, because 10 to 23 it's similar to the H beta, and well, we want to explore how is the behavior. And also for the photoionization course, we get only the flux radius. So it is the figures of the results. So here we have calcium 2 over H beta, and here calcium 2 over passion line. So you can see how the behavior is similar, because, well, the two lines are read by the hydrogen line, so it has to be similar. But one important thing is that the density is only restricted to high density, higher than 10 to 10 in the both cases. And these results are in agreement with the Joly results that were performed in the 80s. But if we look for the oxygen one physical conditions, we can see other different things. You can see how the oxygen one is covering a large range. Also, for when we have the H beta, and also when we have the Paschen lines. So these conditions are similar to the showed by the H beta. So maybe the oxygen one is emitted in the same line that the H beta. But there is an important thing. The dynamic behavior for the oxygen one and the calcium two is very similar. So the dynamic behavior is very similar, but the physical conditions are different. So what is happening? Well, our purpose is that, as the people told in the past, calcium two and Fe2 are emitted also by the accretion disk. But here, the oxygen one, according to the physical conditions that we found, show that maybe it is emitted in other regions. So maybe in the same cloud where H beta is emitted. But this cloud have to be shielded. So oxygen one have to be emitted, for example, in a region that it is shielded and it is not direct to the ionization continuum. Maybe in the last part of these clouds. But how they have the same dynamics and also the same, yes, but why the dynamic is the same? Because maybe calcium 2 and Fe2 are emitted this and in the same level, but in other regions, for example, in a cloud, it's emitted the oxygen 1. So this gives information about the stratification of the stratification of the VLR, and now we have results that show that also oxygen one, part of the oxygen one, could be emitted in the same region that calcium two and Fe2, and also oxygen one could be emitted in the clouds of the VLR. So maybe it can give information. So maybe it is a cartoon. So the structure of the VLR is not that here finish the accretion disk and that's all. And in the next you have the clouds. No, so maybe you have an stratification, and well, it is a hint to try to solve this problem. Okay, so well, we have two kind of samples, and one sample that it's to low luminosity and the other is high luminosity, and low zeta, high zeta. So why not we try to compare our results? So if we compare, for example, the equivalent width of the calcium 2 over the redshift, we can find a different behavior. Well, here we have some sources, but these some sources are special. For example, two of them, the people say that are a double AGN. I don't know. So here it's the region that we can uncover. So these two kind of diagram, it is the redshift and it is the magnitude, absolute magnitude. So this kind of diagrams could be a hint that maybe there is a tendency that in our sources the calcium 2 is higher. But when we compare, for example, the calcium 2 and the Fe2 over the magnitude, the relation is more strong. So maybe why, the question is why in our sample the calcium 2 is high. It is maybe because the calcium 2, it is an alpha element, and the alpha element could be used like a chemical clock. Like the magnesium 2, and I don't remember other line, well, like the magnesium 2, and they increase when we have a star formation burst. So maybe the calcium 2 triplet here is give information that in the intermediate quasar sources we have a resonant star formation burst. So But also there is a possibility that this tendency is only a bias luminosity, and also a bias redshift. So the point is that we have to solve, and we have to measure sources here, and also to cover this kind of redshift, and maybe we found it's possible. And well, these are my conclusions. The main conclusion that is that Fe2 and calcium 2 are emitted by the accretion disk, by the outer part of the accretion disk. However, in this part of the accretion disk, well, this part has to be very dense, with a high density, and also shielded by the continuum ionizing continuum. The behavior of the oxygen one have to take, it's very important only to consider, well, it's very important consider two things, the dynamic behavior and also the physical conditions, because many of the previous job only consider, for example, the dynamic behavior. So they say that, okay, oxygen one and calcium two have the same behavior, so they are emitted in the same place. But the physical conditions tell us other things, so it's very important to consider the two things. And well, the ratio between the comparison between the calcium 2 and the Fe2 could be suggest that there is an enrichment in the VLR due to a recent starburst. But it's a bias luminosity. Well, we don't know. And that's all. Thank you.
I have a very penetrating voice. Sorry. So how do your conclusions fit into the big picture of AGN activity in the so-called unified scheme that we know is not reality, but it's a nice scheme to order things, but not, I mean, last decades it became clear it doesn't describe reality very clearly. So how do your results fit in? Do they contradict? Is there a contradiction to what is expected? Do you find what you expect? Do you not find what you expect? And what does that mean for our understanding of AGN?
Well, it's a good question.
Well, think of me as an outsider.
Yes.
How do you motivate me as an outsider?
Yes. Well, I don't know. In this moment, I can say that my results are not behind, for example, the standard AGN model. Well, but also I can say that it's important for my job. We think that it's very important. It is one of the things that I am working in this moment, the orientations. But I don't know if with my results I only can say that, well, we have at the VLR, it's not the structure that you have. You have the accretion disk. Also, you have maybe the other part of the accretion disk is, I don't remember the word, but they start to be broken. So maybe in this broken, also the ions are emitted. Ions, for example, like the oxygen one. So my results supports to the stratification of the VLR, and also not a strong difference between accretion disk and VLR. Why not make the two regions are connected, and the ions maybe can tell us. But more than, for example, to try to say that the unified model for gradients for my results, I think that in this moment, I don't know, I have to think.
Or that's
to
your results.
Give us a new tool into our hands. Maybe we have a new tool in our hands with your results. Calcium triplet for something.
Yes, I think that, well, I have a tool because we have several lines, and also, for example, in the case of the star formation, we can use like a hint, but also we are exploring an region that for many years was abandoned. So of course we have new information about the oxygen one and the calcium two triplet that are lines that for many of the times are not considered like important lines, but well, they can give you information, why not? And also, let me go to here. Yes. So here it is the thing. For example, here are the population A because we see the outflow, and here are the population B. So also the strong intensity that we observe for the FE2 and the calcium 2 have been related with this. Also, my results could give information about the orientation view angle, but I cannot say more than could be.
Can you show your initial slide? You show the Grotrian diagram of oxygen 1, calcium 2. So for what not the Grotrian diagram where there are the ionized iron, oxygen 1, and calcium 2, the transition levels of these two. So I understand that you find a sort of correlation between the location of oxygen and hydrogen with the H beta line. Okay, now calcium triplet, I'm telling you my experience with the NOVE. Calcium triplet originates from the doublet, the H and K lines that are decayed naturally emits a transition from an excited level, while oxygen 1 originates from a double natural spontaneous decay from an excited level from ultraviolet, whose transition starts from ultraviolet wavelength. Take into account that the transition of the oxygen 1 is very similar to the one of the Lyman alpha transition. So probably you have a pollution by a Lyman alpha emission lines on the oxygen 1. This happened also in the NOVE. And this line, 8446, can be a reflection also of the hydrogen that is in your region. Yes. Maybe this can be an explanation. I don't know if Claudia takes into account this effect.
Yes, Claudia, well, oxygen 1 is pumping by the Lyman. I don't remember what transition, but a Lyman fluorescence. So yes, why the behavior is the same for the oxygen one and the hydrogen lines could be related with this. But yes, Claudi consider also this kind of transitions. Yes.
Able to reduce the pollution by the hydrogen. Okay, thank you.
Yes. Yes, I don't can say many of these, but yes, I'm sure that the transition or the process that is pumping oxygen 1 is included inside Claudi, but also it's totally different of the calcium 2. That in this moment I don't remember what is the process. But yes, it's considered. Yes. Other thing that we tried, when we saw that the oxygen 1 and H beta follow the same behavior, we tried to fix, we have following the eigenvector 1, we say that, okay, for the population A, we can fit a Lorentzian profile, and the population B, we have a double Gaussian, one located in the red frame and the other the other show a redshift. So we try to take our best spectra to try to fit this kind of feature, but the resolution, as you see, it's no... Can we get the same results in the
feed?
So
other neutral oxygen line, like for example the 6300, that is a collision that has a collision of origins, not a fluorescence origin.
Brazilian group use these lines. 1-1-1-2-8-7. They use these lines, but they gain the same results. Yes, but the problem is that our spectra don't cover this region, so it's difficult. But well, maybe we have, for example, there is other UV lines. There is one UV line. But in the spectra that we have in this moment, for example, I can observe this region. But this line, it's affected by absorptions of the... Yes. No, not alluring absorptions, absorption of the galaxy. And also in the intergalactic medium. So I don't have information. It's difficult.
Yes. How can you, I mean, which condition do you use to disentangle the calcium 2 triplet from the oxygen 1 when these two are so blended that I mean? It's
look at only the diagrams here, for example. Yes, here is the oxygen 1. Oxygen 1 in density is very, very, very large. But if you go to the calcium 2 diagram, you can see that it is focused only in a very, very narrow. And well, in the case of oxygen 1, you have emission here also in this range. But in the case of calcium 2, it is not possible. And also, if we consider, for example, a different column density, 10 to 23 or 10 to 24, the results are basically the same. So the important thing here is the density.
I have a comment that probably Jack can do better, but the sequence that you saw is the optical sequence of the Eigenvector value, and it's not clear if it's a continuous sequence or if you have really two different populations, okay? But Jack can explain better his job, of course. I have two questions. The first one is that I don't remember how many sources do you have of population A and population B that have empirical and also different behavior.
Well, I have two samples. One sample is mainly focused on the population B, and the second sample I have majority of the population A. But the first sample is larger, so I think that maybe, yes, 60% of our population B and 40% are population A.
And do you found
any difference in the behavior of that lines comparing one population and another, because the physics could be different? Not only the spectra, about the physical condition and the...
Yes, well, in the case of the population B, the density is not so large. Well, the population B are focused in this, yes, are in this case, are close to small densities, and the stronger are focused on this region. Yes. But well, in this moment, I'm doing, again, cloudy models, but this time we are going to compute the emissivity law, and taking the emissivity law, we are going to compute a dynamics model and try to solve what is the difference, for example, in between the emission in the lines based on the side, where are they are emitted from the AGN, so maybe can help us. But also I can say that, the ions here, when you explore the emissivity law, has a different behavior. And in the case of the emissivity law, the Fe2 and the calcium 2 are not have the same behavior. I don't know why, but I don't know. I'm working on these things in this moment. I don't know. Yes, we know that, we have also to go more and to explore and to try to understand more about the accretion disk, but the accretion disk, it's very difficult. So now also I am performing some models, consider extra heating and also these kind of things that are very difficult for me for the theoretical accretion disk. Well, vertical, consider a vertical structure also, but the results are not yet, so maybe in the future I can say any.
Any further questions? No. Thank you, Maria.
Thank you.